All right, so back to this discussion of the evolution. Back to when we are at, I'll say at the tuber stage, when we're getting out, getting at the potatoes, we're starting out in the savanna lands. We are starting to begin hunting more and more. Okay, so while all of this is going on, there is a different culture happening because these we're starting to be able to collect and keep. So because we're becoming collect and keep, that's changing our mindset, okay? Because before we did not collect and keep. This is all of a sudden new. We can keep these vegetables, store them through the many months of winter. This is becoming a new collection group, you know. If I get 150 of those, I can keep them all through winter. Okay, so now this is starting to become a monetary item. What you can keep through winter, okay, and if you can also include as well a habitation zone, if you can include your tribal stay, because it's difficult to drag those items around, your collection items. Now you see the Mongolians, they travel twice a year, and they do take their items twice a year, you know, the whole house, everything goes. But in the true reality, it starts to become tougher and tougher, those escapades. So here you have, now we're getting cozy. We have a cozy little house, a little place to stay. We have the let's say I have 150 sweet potatoes, and that becomes like, wow, you know, maybe somebody collected only 110. That's like my neighbor, but in my tribe, and yet I collected 150. You know, so I have 40 more. And maybe another neighbor over there only collected 10. So thusly, this dude is not bringing, he's not bringing it into the pot, is he? He's not bringing it into the tribe. He's becoming like a real pain, because this one worked for 150 tubers and the other worked for the 110 tubers, and this one only worked for 10. In a way, it's like, no, that's a no good. We don't like you. Okay, so in other words, already now we're starting to have classes. Classes are starting to organize. That, well, this is 150 tubers is a higher priority. And she can now, or he can now, say, ah, you are in essence my slave, because you are only giving 10 tubers through. So I have power, higher power over you, because you're not pulling your weight. Okay, so we even have that moment going on. So now we're starting to develop this ego of the power game, okay, just based upon on the collection, the work collection cycle, what you've collected in your work cycle. Okay, so now some of us in the tribe say, we don't even want the guy. We don't care if he's your slave or if he does things for you extra around your hut. We don't care. We do not want him here. We don't like him. He's just not pulling his weight. So we can kick him out like a wolf, like the wolves do. They say, enough, you're a lone wolf now. Aha, great. Okay, so here we are, prosperous tribe. Everything's going swell. We feel like we can collect and keep our abodes. But that guy left. We kicked him out. And then maybe he makes another little tribe, okay, and comes back and attacks us. So he is not the greatest dude ever, is he? Because now we kicked him out, he can actually turn back and fight us. Now, he doesn't have to return and fight us. He can play other games. He can be more like the pygmy headhunters of Papua New Guinea, and he can just say, just screw you. If you walk near my place, pal, I'll cut your head off, and I'll stick it on a pole. So he could turn that direction. That could be his evolution tribe into that direction. Because he didn't want to collect. He did not want to be a collector, did he? He preferred to just do Papua New Guinea style and collect heads as a joke. I'll collect the heads, I'll stick them on the pole. And you walk my way, you become one. And so that became that group. I believe there still are a few of them out there that if you do approach, you will just become gone. And that's the way they are. Because they don't want to barter with you. They don't care if you have beads. They don't care if you have little furry dice. They don't want any of your items. They don't care if you have a mango that is really delicious. They don't care if you have bananas. They will eat their diet as it is. They don't care what you offer. They don't want to trade. They prefer their isolation. They prefer their keep. That's their way of fighting and keeping and sustaining their habitation, that zone. Okay, so that could have happened to that lazy dude. The lazy dude could have turned into one of those, like a serial head guy. So the lazy dude, who was only bringing back the 10 tubers, we kicked him out of the tribe. But either way, this one that is collecting and collecting, this one that has 150 now, she has 150 tubers, she needs storage. She has to have cellars and storages and things. So, I mean, this they're becoming so advanced, aren't they? Because they have to count. They have to start counting. And counting, well, I have more than you. And that becomes like another brain. You know, 3 for you, 5 for me, whatever. It becomes another brain. We're starting to count and calculate. Okay, so now we're becoming greedy over those. And we're starting to put this diminutive power, you're less because of what you have acquired, what you have collected, you're less. Okay, and you are more, just like the king. I mean, and there's the king, you know. And originally, the kings must have really just been great collectors. Must have been excellent collectors, and so they were adored. They were adored, but I can't collect as much as him. Even if he was a king, a bad king, and he became a collector because maybe he stole or even killed somebody and stole his collections, it doesn't matter. He would still be risen to the king level. He would rise to that status of their gods because he had so much. He had acquired. Okay, whether it was a good acquisition, a fair acquisition, or one done through murderous means. Okay, so here he's now an acquirer king. I believe there were probably a few queens out there. I don't know. I always say king. But still, interestingly, is that guy out there, the Papua New Guinea. Never forget him, you know, and his tribe. That's a very, very funny group. Because they've decided not to go back to the trees in that essence, but they're not really leaving the trees either. They stay in their subterfuge zone, and they're pretty much into a lot of meat. I believe they're into hunting. They capture and hunt. So they are still lazy. They are still man-made lazy. They're those types of tribes. Because they just want the fast kill and the fast cook and eat. You know, they're lazy. I can't really call them lazy because they had to develop the tools. But in the after, you know, if you look at the mammoth, you look at these big vessels of food. You know, whether they're wild boar or whatever. You know, it takes a long time to eat it, so you don't have to gather this day and the next day and the day after that. So in essence, they are lazy after the hunt. You know, it gives them a lot more time to just laze around. Okay, so yeah, they have fewer gatherer days needed. Anyway, so now we're getting back to, I know I got into the successionism moment. When we have acquired more vegetables, there's this succession moment. So now we're looking at obviously that becomes a payment, starts to turn into monetary, starts to turn into it's floating in my head, I can't find it right now, but yeah, starting to turn into a monetary currency. And they will even find, those tribes will even find other tribes that have items interesting, and then they start to trade. You know, I'll trade you my 150 sweet potatoes for your 150 kiwis. Okay, so we start to do these strange things. We start to trade, and those are nice and polite trades, but then sometimes they're not. Sometimes they will just fight to the death to kill, to take, you know. But after a while, that gets boring. I don't think there's too much of that fight to the kill and take, because the first group was gathering those sweet potatoes. So why kill them? You know, why would you bother to kill them? It's much better not to, because if we go and we just go and kill them for the sweet potatoes this one time, we don't get them next year. You know, so they have to think forward in advance, because they can't actually populate that quickly to make another tribe that would be able to go and gather sweet potatoes. So in a way, they're like, why did we do that? Because now, backtracking, we have to go just be friends again. Let's be friends and not kill so many tribes. And then we can share more food, more different types of varieties. Okay, all of this, we've left the jungle. Okay, we're out of the jungle. We cannot be in the jungle still. Now, there are obviously things in the jungle that kill us, you know, all kinds of things like that, but we're still not running back to it. And there are the Amazon tribes that did stay. They're still classed as being jungle indigenous. But for the most part, white man, African American man, Chinese man, all of these, we left the jungles. And when that was all going on, all of this started, this bartering started to occur more and more, and this monetary, and the elevation of status. Okay, so now we have elevation of status. Now, we're bringing this elevation of status even further and true into our time now, and going, well, it's not really that much different. We have the celebrated one, the one who's celebrated, the one who's bringing the most to the tribe, bringing the most back to the family. That is the celebrated one. Okay, so the celebrated, normally now it's a male. The celebrated male is given this big ego, you know, good for him, and he can do pretty much what he wants. He's a great guy because he brings so much back to us. And the women are diminutive in that moment because of the celebrated male. They shrink in their, you know, he has weapons. Not only does he have an ego, but he has weapons. So he's an arms dealer from the past, you know. And the women don't. The women are just like, well, we just are gatherers. And he comes back with something that feeds everybody for a long, long time. And so he is given this rise in status, and plus he has the weapons. Okay, so this goes on for years and years and years and years. Okay, and I'm talking like thousands and thousands of years that way, where this man has the hierarchy as the ego. But now, fun time city, here we are in this Western world, and we have, since the 1950s, we're just seeing that big bring home celebrated ego male is now, here's a big bring home celebrated ego female. And she's rising, she's going to work, she's on her power trip. And she's bringing home, isn't she? She's bringing it home. And he's like, what the heck? I've been doing this for thousands of years, and she's Miss Professional now. Okay, so you've got a lot of guys saying goodbye, and then when they say goodbye, they decide to do less. They will be the diminutive male. They will trade places. So they are like, well, I'll just shrink from my big ego and love you. I'll just love you. Okay, so that becomes a different type of male. Okay, so this is a new guy though, new guy in town. Now, this female now, she's so high up, and she's like, oh, I don't really want that type of guy. You know, I prefer an ego guy like me, a power male. I want a power male and a power female. Give me the power. You know, those two, well, I don't know, you know, power. When you get power, you put your fingers together real like that, and they kind of bounce off each other. When you put power and power together, it can't actually touch. So it creates a different type of a relationship. Okay. So we still have the diminutive relationship existing, but now we see a lot of males taking that role. And yet we are still trying. We have a bunch of males that are still trying their power, and females are trying their power, and they're like, that's it. You know, so we're at this loggerhead moment. Loggerheads, and where am I here? Loggerheads, yeah. So we have a lot of fails going on in relationships just this past 30, 40, 50 years. Very interesting.